Hello and welcome to Unpacking Terms. The term we're going to be unpacking today is a complicated one, and that is noticing. And what I'll present here is a simplified version of the great work by many scholars, particularly Richard SCHMIDT, who proposed the noticing hypothesis, as well as Ron Leo and Bill Van Patten. So what is noticing? Noticing, according to SCHMIDT, is one level of awareness, and it involves conscious attention to something in the input. And Van Patten adds that it's noticing something new or different in the input. There is a higher level of awareness, according to SCHMIDT, and that is understanding. Understanding involves awareness of abstract rules, generalizable patterns, for example, metalinguistic knowledge, that is, knowledge about the language itself, how the language works. According to the noticing hypothesis, noticing is necessary for input to become intake. And I'll get to that term in just a minute. So, in other words, if something is not noticed, then it is impossible to be acquired, according to the noticing hypothesis. At the same time, just because something is noticed, that does not mean that it has been acquired or that it will be acquired. What about understanding, this higher level of awareness? SCHMIDT says that it is facilitative, but it's not required for acquisition. So let's talk about input and intake. You've got to think of it as almost like an onion or a circle inside of another circle. So you have input that is available to the learner, but not all of that input becomes intake. For SCHMIDT, input that is noticed then can become intake, and eventually it gets internalized or acquired. It becomes part of the developing system. So intake is a preliminary stage along the acquisitional process, as Leo described. Intake is held in short-term memory, it is not yet internalized or acquired, and it eventually could become part of the system. Do people agree in general that not all input becomes intake? Yes. But how or what conditions lead to intake? That's where scholars disagree. And in a minute, we'll see a different take on intake. For the noticing hypothesis, it is possible to learn incidentally, but it is not possible to learn without awareness. So what SCHMIDT is saying is that incidental learning means that it's not planned. So for example, if you're just reading a book, you can learn from noticing things in that input, and that is incidental learning because it was not planned. But SCHMIDT says you're still aware of things in the input. Learning without awareness, on the other hand, for SCHMIDT is not possible. And the example that he gives is that if you are unaware that you're being corrected, then that correction will have absolutely no effect in terms of acquisition. And as you can probably imagine, not everybody agrees with these statements. Some criticisms that have been made about the noticing hypothesis are, first, very hard to operationalize and measure. How do you truly measure or pinpoint that a learner is showing a certain level of awareness? In most research, there is a bias towards explicitness. So when we use methods such as think alouds, which is the learner verbalizing what they're thinking, we're only accessing explicit knowledge. We may not be actually accessing all of the knowledge. Even when we measure whether something is effective or not, most tests that are used in SLA research tend to tap into explicit knowledge. Learners have time to monitor their production. They have time to think about rules, if you will, to think about what they know about the language. And another criticism is that the noticing hypothesis is based on cognitive psychology research and personal experiences of SCHMIDT. And so some question how valid it is to apply cognitive psychology principles to second language acquisition, since acquiring a language is not the same as learning anything else. And of course, personal experiences are usually not the most reliable empirical evidence. And so we are back to square one. At the end of the day, the debate of the noticing hypotheses is all about which camp you're in. Strong, weak, or no interface positions, which we unpacked in another video. If you agree that acquisition is mostly implicit, and implicit means without awareness, then is any level of awareness really necessary? Now, there's one more distinction that is important to make, and the distinction is between noticing and processing. So remember that we talked about the circles inside of a circle? Not all input becomes intake. Van Patten agrees with that. But for Van Patten, it's not about noticing the input, but rather about processing the input. Input that is processed is what can become intake. So Van Patten reminds everybody that noticing, as proposed by SCHMIDT, only involves becoming aware of something in the input. SCHMIDT said nothing about making form-meaning connections. So a learner might notice something, they might go, I've never noticed that before. But they may not be making any form-meaning connections. They're not actually linking that form that they just noticed with any meaning in particular. So, for example, on this slide, a learner might notice the S after connections. And that little S, that form, gives me the meaning of more than one or plural. But technically, a learner could notice, could become aware of that S, but they could not potentially even know that that S means plural. Now, processing, on the other hand, is about making form-meaning connections. And processing could happen implicitly, meaning without awareness. Van Patten emphasizes this point by saying that processing would be laboriously slow and cumbersome if indeed a learner had to consciously register each and every piece of datum that came across the linguistic threshold. What does this mean for the classroom? Classroom applications that are premised on noticing would be things like input enhancement, where you underline, bold, or change the color of certain words or certain morphemes, maybe a verb ending, for example. According to Van Patten, the students notice that you underline, they notice that something is bold, but they may or may not assign a particular meaning to those forms that they're noticing. On the other hand, structured input, which we unpacked in another video, is about processing. The students are pushed to make form-meaning connections. And we cannot acquire without making form-meaning connections. And therefore, what is necessary is processing as opposed to noticing. So after all this very complex explanation, I'm hoping that what you take away is to prioritize processing over noticing. Instead of thinking how we can make the input more salient so that learners can notice forms, let's think about how we can help them link these forms to the right meaning. There's still a lot more to unpack, so be sure to subscribe. Thank you for tuning in, and until next time.